everybody. Good afternoon. Today is Monday, May 17th, the Monday after the UFC 262 weekend. Today we got your host, CeeLos, and myself, SchMoe.
How's everybody doing today?
Hopefully you guys are doing great. We're just briefly going to talk about it. I was, again, just like a few weeks back, I was not in town. I was at another wedding, but I only got to actually see the part of the co-main event, and then also, well, the main event as well. Which, I mean, yes, last time I picked the Kukui, giving him the benefit of the doubt that he was going to truck it out. But, whatever. Things happened the way it happened.
Yeah, we'll get into that fight.
And then, that happened. Yeah. So go ahead, CeeLos. What do you think about the first fight of that main card? Edson Barboza.
Barboza, man, like we talked about him. He's just an exciting fighter. He's been doing it forever. And, he has his up and downs. Sometimes he's really on, but he always comes to fight. And that was a fight. That was a good fight. He was able to get the TKO, right? And on that one, you had picked
Barboza. I picked Barboza, right?
So
right.
You were up one, right? So I was like, I was already thinking to myself, I'm like, bro, is this going to be
another
loss?
Remember, we went sideways. It could have been. Now, I strongly believe that, this is the mentality or the demeanor, the vigor that Barboza went in there with. I mean, maybe Kukui needed some of that as well. But I believe, though, that he is still legit. This is the proper way to also go up in your rank by, you're in the main card, so you need a splash. You need that pizzazz, and he stopped him. You don't need a decision. So I believe this is the proper way that, well, actually, what Dana White and the fans want for this is the way, this is what you got to do. You got to come in, and if there's some sort of doubt, no, you got to completely.
Exactly, bro. He was bleeding and everything. I mean, they were both landing good jabs. They were landing, good blows. It was a lot of, they put on a show. It went to the third round, right? And he was able to get the TKO.
That's perfect.
So it was like we said, could have been fight of the night.
Could have been fight.
And I think it ended up being fight of the night.
Well, remember, let's not forget about the main event, though. I mean, that one.
That this one probably was because the main event, I mean, it only went two rounds.
Right. So that's actually awesome right there. You are definitely correct on that. Nothing boring, no sleepers, no snoozers.
Yeah.
For three full rounds, you got action. So that's legit right there. That comment, that right there could go ahead and sway.
We got a Barboza fight. That's what we got, bro. Perfect. He doesn't disappoint. He's always worth the ticket,
Perfect.
So the night started good. Then it started slowing down, right?
Right. So the Katlyn and the Viviane Araujo fight,
It went the distance. It was close, really close. They were both trading, right? And the first round, I think personally, what's her name? The Brazilian girl?
Viviane Araujo.
Yeah, I think she won the first, clearly, to me, right? You could say that there was some kind of controversy on the decision, right, on that one, because it was so close. I think the scores were like 29-28, and then one judge did like a 30-27, which was outrageous.
Ah, they read on that, though.
I thought it was going to be a split decision. It was close.
So it was
unanimous. Could honestly tell you, kept trading back and forth. There were submissions. They were going out on the feet. But in the towards the later round, you could see where she slowed down.
Okay.
Viviane slowed down, right? Because she put so much input in the first round and a half that Chookagian took over, and she was just dominating after that. And I think that's what got her the thing, right? So at the end, she did kind of like just take over the second and the third round. So I think she did win. I think it was closer than the 30-27 show, right? The 29-28
probably.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree with, but one it was a really good fight. You could have gone either way.
So 1-2 then. Maybe Katlyn got two rounds and maybe just one.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it, like I said, the second round was closer, right? It could have gone either way. But I guess they gave it to her because of her output at the end. She was a little bit more aggressive. You could see that Viviane was tired, but it was a good fight.
Okay. All right. So maybe better than I hoped. That was going to be a little more snoozy, but okay.
Yeah, it was a better fight.
So you got that one. So moving on to the fight number three.
1-1 at that point.
Against Michael Christopher, can't pronounce his last name, and Rogelio also.
Yes.
That's
another one that was really close. It was back and forth, a lot of, you know, trading. I think it went to the power punches, right? Little bit of the power, powerful ground game is what gave him the edge. But that was another one that went decision. It could have gone either way. They gave it to Rogelio. Yeah. They gave it to him, and then it, that gave me the lead, right? And it put me at 2-1
right?
For the card.
Okay.
So let's get to the co-main event, right? Because before we start on that, let's start on how much of a big fan I am of Tony Ferguson. And I told you that it sucked that I had a pick against him, right? I was trying to... You're
trying to break the curse.
I was trying to get him better. I was trying to break
the curse. If at any other point, I would have probably also picked against him. But mm-hmm. It was just in this one, I was like... Since number one, I was just, let's go opposite of CeeLo. So let's just let's always pick the opposite side.
Yeah.
And also, not only because of that, because I thought he was going to show up and be focused. He did look good, but.
Yeah. So I could honestly say, bro, I'm always going to be a Tony Ferguson fan, right? I'm always going to root for him personally to win, right? Obviously, when we did the little betting or the little picks, right, I did it just as a competition to try to win an event since I'm down to an event. But I'm a big Tony Ferguson fan. I'm always going to support him. I hope he does bounce back. Bro, he was put on a nasty ankle hook that twisted
his knee. He failed to tap out like
when against Oliveira. He did not tap out. Bro, you could see the pain in his face, and he just – recovered. I don't know what kind of mentality Tony has, right, to go past that pain. But supposedly, this guy said he heard it pop. He's like, I heard it pop. Like, I don't know how he recovered. I don't know how he's
the same standing. Knee that he received surgery on not that long ago.
Tony, man, look, I think you were right on one thing, right? I think that he should go up and wait. I think he should go up and wait because you could see it. You could see it on his... the way he looks for the fight, right? He looks really drained. And also you could see it.
Remember this is fight night, not weigh-in.
Yeah.
So weigh-in, he looks even worse for the weigh-in. So fight night, I don't even know how much weight he's gaining, but he's it's not enough.
Yeah. And he looks
drained.
But not only that, you know how like when you lose weight, it messes with your stamina and stuff like that.
Of course.
You could see his input. And he's not young, bro. He's 37 years old. Let's not forget that.
Exactly.
He had a 12, you know, fight winning streak before he started losing. He's been fighting, and he's been fighting top
contenders. His last win was Pettis. Yeah.
Yes.
That's his last win, you know?
So, but like I said.
And he's not fighting twice a year, you know?
Not no more. Not since the knee injury. But he was fighting for a while. Like he was putting in fights like twice a year.
Putting in fights, but it's like it's not there anymore.
I mean, he put two fights in 2020, bro. He put two fights in 2020.
I'm trying to remember both of them because I can't. I mean, I got Pettis.
The two losses. Losses were in 2020.
He's only fought once in the 2021.
Yeah, this is the first time he loses in 2021, yeah.
So you got Oliveira?
Mm-hmm.
And then who was he fighting?
He lost to Gaethje, remember?
Oh, I'm sorry. Pardon. Yes. Gee.
In 2020, he did fight twice and they were both losses.
Yeah, so then with Gaethje, right. With Gaethje and then Oliveira, right.
Exactly.
So,
but, I mean, like I said, bro, he is a soldier.
When I was three new losses, right. Well, I mean.
So I think maybe a change of weight class could help him.
Hold on a second. Let's go here because he's in a bad spot because let's say – okay, let's say you're John Jones and maybe the light heavyweight division is, you know, with Blackwood's there and a few other guys that are hungry, this is kind of getting a little too tough. As you saw, nobody cares about Dominic Reyes anymore. Hey, you did great against Jones, but it's my turn right now, right?
Yeah,
as we saw with Prozac as whatever, the karate guy, legit. So hold on a second. He's got to go to heavyweight. Heavyweight, he might have some sort of a chance because, you have some other guys there. Stipe's not getting any younger.
Hey, that guy's looking like a beast. He's looking like a beast, right?
Yes. What I'm saying is maybe John Jones can have some success in a good amount of success in heavyweight. But have you seen welterweight? What's Tony going to do?
I know there's, bro, there's a lot of good competition in the UFC.
That's what I'm saying. There's
a lot of good
competition. There's a lot of competition.
But you know what? It's something that Rogan said
Is he going to go to middle? He doesn't have the body for, I mean, at this point, he's going to have to bulk
I mean, he
up.
Has to try something because he's just not, he's getting outmaneuvered in his own game.
He's losing on his feet against
grappling,
and he's losing on the floor. So Chael Sonnen said it. You can no longer, especially legit grapplers, you can't fight off your back anymore. Yes, he was doing it. Tony was known for fighting off his back and winning off his back.
There's two things that they said on the broadcast, right? Both DC and Rogan. Rogan says something that is true. This is a young man's game, right? We've seen it. We've seen the evolution of the UFC from when it first started.
I think Randy Couture is showing and, you know, there's guys always, just can't do it anymore.
Exactly. There's always like...
Unless you're Joel Romero. But
there's always like a 3-year, 4-year period where something gets, you know, like common, and then it starts getting evolved again to something else. Right. There's always an evolution of the game. There's a lot more technique into it. There's a lot more strategy into it. And then DC did say something, right? Tony, when he first started, he was very unpredictable, right? He was very you just couldn't predict his movement.
It was a lot of unorthodox stuff. Yes. I completely agree.
He was saying that since he never worked on his fundamentals, right? Like now he has no fundamentals to fall back because he was always so over the place.
Right.
His unpredictability. It's showing and he doesn't have the agility or the strength that he had when he was younger. So now it's coming to, you know, fruition where it's really getting to him. But he's always going to fight. Yeah, he has to fight.
Let's talk about a legend, right? Let's talk about Roy Jones Jr., right?
Yeah.
The guy was an incredible beast throughout the entirety of his career until Tarver comes around. Right.
What was it? His fiber muscle, right?
Not only that. I'm saying Tarver was the first one that started because it beat him again. Tarver completely wrecked him. At that point, Roy Jones Jr. was losing that reflex. Right. Which is the only thing.
Which is the fiber muscle.
He never had a stiff
jab. That twitch makes you so quick.
Exactly. Roy Jones Jr.'s legacy were his reflexes.
Yes.
So same thing with
the best at it.
Bring it in over here. You're bringing it over here. The same thing I said about Michael Venom Page.
He would never block.
The moment
he would never block.
Right. The moment he loses that little spring there, because that's all he has.
We're starting to see it with the Matrix guy.
With Lomachenko.
Yeah, we're starting to see it with him because you know there are a lot of movement.
His thing is footwork.
Yeah.
His thing is always footwork. But
once you get a little bit slower,
you grab Tommy Fumio Lopez, and it's like, well, I'm also young. I already got all these belts. I'm going to go ahead and take yours. He matched his footwork and took him apart. Exactly. So you can say that about a lot of athletes. Russell Wilson, he's a small quarterback. The moment he loses that leg, what are you going to do when you can't see over the guys that are 6'5"?
And in basketball, you got Westbrook. Westbrook, what makes him so good is the way he moved, the quickness.
At AI, one point, he's going to have to learn how to shoot
look at
better.
AI.
Because, yeah,
when he was in basketball. AI
right.
was so
he was
smaller
known for breaking
than everybody.
Ankles. He was known but for
was
breaking
quick.
Ankles.
Yeah.
He was known for breaking ankles. And at one moment, you're going to fix your game. Kobe did it.
You cannot.
Did
the
it.
Only person that has beat Father Time for some reason, I don't know what deal he did
Bernard
with the
Bernard Hopkins.
Is Tom Brady. No, but I'm talking about like also in sports. It's Tom Brady. Tom Brady is like 40-something years old.
Well, remember, in the quarterback position, you can last a little longer. Kickers also.
Now, you're
not a running back.
But Tom Brady's been playing since the 2000s.
That is true, though. That's true. Like 17 good years
playing,
as the starting quarterback.
He was playing as the rules were changing, right?
That's
so
true.
He did come
when they were
in
protecting
the were,
more. Oh, true, yes. true. The rules went to his but, benefit because
yeah,
we got to protect
towards, yeah, towards the end, but
well, I mean,
he did play at a time when you still could hit quarterbacks.
Let's not forget
that he didn't have – he had at least 4 or 5 years in that system where you still could at least abuse the quarterback a little
yeah,
bit
I remember
more,
the
yeah.
way Trent Green's, you know, career
exactly.
ended and all these guys. So,
little
yeah,
by little, the rules have changed.
Yeah.
Offensively,
so,
it's more of an offensive game.
But that's the thing. The rules have not changed in MMA. It's been the same thing for a while. I mean, well, now the only thing that has changed is now you got to get more cardio because even if it's not a title fight and you're in a main event, it's not 3 rounds anymore. It's going to be 5 regardless.
It depends on the fight, though. He said that it depends on the fight. It depends on – if it's going to be a co-main event and it's one like for like
main event though. If it's a main event, even if it's a fight night, you're going to fight 5 rounds. You know,
yes.
Whittaker and Till
correct,
did
correct.
It, and
you're
it
right,
wasn't
right,
a
right
no
that.
No
yeah.
title. Right, right, right.
You're right.
Just,
that.
Just because you know they what that.
So again, I mean, that, so, it was a good fight. I don't know if how much of the fight you caught.
Oh no,
but
no,
it was
no.
a really good fight.
It was great, but I mean, again, the grappler got him.
Yeah, and bro,
and again, he didn't tap out.
But let's give credit where credit is due because that guy came in with a game plan. he saw that he was able to control him on the ground. And instead of standing up and taking the chance of getting caught, he's like, I'll just keep it on the ground.
Why would you get up, though, if you know this is your forte? If you saw Ryan Bader against Machida, Ryan Bader was absolutely not going to stand up and repeat the horrible knockout that he got last time.
You know what I'm saying?
So I'm just going to
lay on. Point.
And by the way, if Ryan Bader is 205, you're got to be lying to me in my face. That guy at least had to go in there looking like he was 230. But whatever, he made weight.
Yeah, he was like he was like 225.
He was insane. He had to gain like 20 pounds overnight. But anyway,
so that put me up, and that made me win the event. Let's just make that clear.
But it put you up. I'm still a little disappointed. Not only because I did lose the thing, it's just, man, you wanted to see Tony. You know,
I was rooting for Tony. Rooting for him.
You know, and Melee, he's going to be yet another fighter that's never going to get a title shot. And
exactly.
You said it last time. This is it.
All right. So, guys, this is a question for the people in the audience, right? What do you think about Tony Ferguson? Do you think his career is over? Do you think he needs to move up in weight? Right. You know, leave a comment below. Let us know. So let's move on to the main event.
Oh, hey, speaking of people that whose careers might be, not might be over. There was hit and miss Jacare.
Yeah.
What happened with Jacare?
I think he lost.
I think he lost. He got knocked out, though. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think he lost.
I don't know if he lost or he got knocked out.
I know that they talked about it because Joe Rogan was like, he could tell, like, that's why he was saying the comment about this is a young man's game. But I think he lost. I think he got knocked out.
Well, remember he was 41 fighting a 31-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just pull it up real quick because I didn't even, you know, in our bad that I didn't pick it up. But
yeah, that's your boy. And, I mean, I think he's been done for a little minute, bro.
He lost in the first round.
Mm-hmm.
1 minute left, and he got submitted. So
correct.
Okay, so obviously you saw how he just was just dragging, gradually dropping. Yes, he had that nice knockout against Weidman, but it was Weidman. Remember we talked? Weidman has no chin anymore.
Mm-hmm.
It's a glass jaw. He sees it coming. It's not like Rockhold. He sees it coming. It's just, you know, he's gonna go down, and then it's just been loss after loss.
Correct.
So my thing, this is going to be, if this is just, you know, we're going to see Ferguson, unfortunately, in the undercard.
I think they're still going to put him in the main card just because his name, the crowd was behind him.
Crowd was behind Mike Perry.
The crowd's going to pay for him, right? He's a money maker.
Carlos Condit.
Let's think about it. He's like Nate Diaz. Nate Diaz hasn't won, really. He loses a lot of the matches, right? He still lost to George Masvidal, and we're still excited to see him fight Edwards, right?
Right. Remember, it was a doctor stoppage, though. I mean, it was a loss, but it was that open thing kick right here.
But it's exciting to watch fight, right? So Tony's amazing. People love him. They're going to watch him. He's not going to go to the undercard. He's just, like I said, it's unfortunate that this guy had a 12 fight winning streak. Every time they set up
has a three-fight losing streak.
Yeah, but let's, you know, it's unfortunately he never got to fight for the belt, right? He never got to fight Khabib. Every time they set it up, something weird happened, right?
And now Khabib retired, and he's gotten a leg hurt.
And he's just he's not in his prime no more.
And that's it.
You see the difference in the fighter.
That's it.
You know, it is what it is. I feel bad for his career because
I do feel bad because we don't know if he would have gotten that one chance, what could have happened.
Yeah, when he was in his prime,
when he was different. Yeah, exactly. remember that knee was the end of his prime.
Pretty much.
Yeah. So.
Pretty much. I mean, he still came back and he won two fights right after the knee surgery, and he came back. Remember, he's like I said, he's another. He's just a different level of human, bro. Because he came.
He won one fight after the knee surgery. It was one fight.
Yeah, and two fights.
And Pettis was even able to get on top a few times.
No, it was two fights, bro. Who it was two fights after the knee.
Wins. Who were the two wins?
One of them was Pettis. I can't remember the other one, but it was two fights.
Pettis was the same event as McGregor Khabib that he was supposed to have been in.
Correct.
I can't remember.
I think Cowboy might be the other one. I don't remember.
Cowboy's another one just like that. He just never got there. A lot of, you know, obviously not everybody can be a champion, but this is a sport where the champion can change a lot. You know?
Exactly.
As people said, and nobody gives a damn about the sport. Luke Rockhold had him. Hey, Machida has. I mean, I don't know if you can call it the era, but he was destroying people.
He beat.
And then he went on a slump.
So he beat. He had a fight with Donald. I think you're always forgetting about that fight, because every time I tell you, like, yeah, he did have two wins.
I'm trying to remember the Donald fight with Ferguson.
He whooped him. He whooped Donald so nasty. It wasn't even.
I can't. Close. You know what? I mean, obviously, again, we're not analysts. I can't remember all these fights either because, you know, I enjoyed my weekend. But,
so after the knee surgery, he fought Anthony Pettis.
And then
6 months after the knee surgery, which was crazy.
And then Cowboy.
And then he fought Cowboy.
Oh,
and
so Cowboy TKO'd was his last Cowboy. Win. So Cowboy was his last
That was
win.
In 2019.
Okay.
That was the only 2019 fight that he had. And then in May, is when he lost to Gaethje, right? And then he lost to.
So speaking on that, I mean, hopefully we don't over talk, but you're getting all the evidence right there. Age. Mm-hmm. Cerrone was legit. Ferguson was legit. Uriah Faber was legit, right?
Bro, who else was legit?
BJ Penn.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know, BJ Penn, Uriah Faber, hell, Wanderlei Silva.
Think about it. Oliveira doesn't have that much longer before he starts his decline. He's been fighting since he was 20 years old. That dude has been fighting since he was 20 years old.
Well, you know what? It doesn't matter if he's 40 or 35 now. He's the champ.
Yeah, he's the champ. I mean, he won the belt.
He got to wherever. If you saw the emotion on his face, he got there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I think, you know, Chandler got a little too fast-tracked for that fight. But whatever. I'm not the one that makes the fights. Whatever.
Hey, let me tell you that. Let's talk about the main event, right? So the Charlie, that fight was exciting, bro.
Right.
That is what a main event should be. They this guy came
out. It ended differently than what I thought because I wanted Chandler – to commit to his
game plan, bro.
And then we have Oliveira counter and then just drop him and you know, arm lock or get him on a Kimura or something.
Let me tell you that.
It ended up Oliveira knocked him out.
Yeah. Hey, let me tell you that Chandler would not. Hey, Chandler caught him like 3 or 4 times that he almost knocked him out.
Yes.
He almost knocked him out.
Round one, he came swinging round one.
Yeah. He almost knocked him out. And my thing is, like I told you when we talked earlier, right, that I think that he should have won the match, right? Because there was a point where he really rocked him. And you see Oliveira fall to the ground, and then he follows through with 2 punches. But as soon as Oliveira gave his back, he got scared.
Right, because
he did not want to get in. Yeah.
Legitimate.
He didn't want to get in the ground.
Not want to go on the ground because Oliveira can trap you, you know? You can get trapped. So if that happens – right there, they're going, your, you know, a lot of your dreams and hopes, right?
I can't complain though. That match was everything that you want to see in a main event.
Right.
Hey,
right.
And let me tell you, when Oliveira came out in the second round, I thought he was going to try to take it to the ground, but nope, he stood up. He got a couple quick jabs in there, right? Because this guy was throwing. He was throwing haymakers to try to knock him out.
Yes, he was.
And then he caught him really good, hurt him, and he finished.
And that's Chandler's demise right there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I thought that one of those haymakers, he was going to just high crouch under it and take him down. But I guess we were talking, like, people don't get cocky about, you know, folks being one-sided. Like, when we mentioned that Masvidal was a one-trick pony. Hey, let's not forget that Usman can pick up also on standing up. He can pick that up, you know.
Let me tell you, man. Oliveira, like we said, he's been fighting since he was 20 years old. His record is 31-8-1 no contest, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've seen him develop into the fighter that he is now.
Right.
Besides Khabib, right?
Unfortunately, it could be just a light candle where it's a big fire and then it just burns out right away.
Yeah,
because it took this long for him to get there.
And then, bro, all his fights, we're talking about right there, that's 49, that's 39 fights already in his career. And he's 30-something already. So, I mean, hopefully he has a long range.
You got to remember, still nothing compared to Muay Thai fighters.
Exactly. I mean, those guys, but
they're already at 150 fights by the time they're 18. You know, so it's insane. It's insane. But he's got a lot of fights under his belt. A lot of, you know, so-called legends, Forrest Griffin or whatever, have retired with the less fights. Under their belt, so this might be one of those where, you know, some other hungry younger guy at one point. Hopefully, he can defend his belt once or twice. But again, I don't see this lightweight is a hot potato. It's a hot potato.
Bro, you got Gaethje still. You're gonna have this guy Chandler come back because he's not done, right? He's gonna get another chance.
Gaethje has the upper hand. He is still a little younger.
Yeah, Gaethje's next, right? So I think whoever Gaethje, actually no. Let me take that back because they already said that I think the winner of of the rematch of the third trilogy fight between
McGregor
and this guy.
McGregor is another one that I don't know what he's doing at 155.
He should be 170.
But he knows that at 170, he can't dominate. He probably walks around at 180.
He can't dominate at 170, bro. He can't. Not at 170.
And that's what I'm talking about. What is Tony going to do? You could probably go up to, you know, go up there and have some success. But, I mean, you got guys there that either they're going to choke you out or knock you out.
Look, right now.
And they've been at that weight class for right a lot longer, so they're more comfortable.
In 170, to me, the best fighter is Kobe. Everybody could hate him for his political stance.
No. You don't have to hate him for that. You know that he gives you that output the same as Gaethje.
I think he's the only one that actually could beat Usman right now.
If you remember, though, he was up. If it wasn't for that jaw, just like you mentioned that Araujo-Caitlin fight, one of those judges had, before that fifth round, one of those judges had it 4-1.
Yeah,
was about to give that last round to Covington anyway. So even the round where Covington got his jaw broken, they were still giving it to Covington.
I mean, it's the way he throws punches, the imp, like you said, the
it's output a lot
that
he of throws, output. Yeah, yeah.
Bro, the guy doesn't apart. Stop.
Right,
and he has technique.
He has technique.
So let's end the video now because it's actually gone longer than we expected. So guys, what did you think about the event? If you watched it in 262, right? The next event is 263, which is going to be the Leon Edwards and Nate Diaz fight. Leave comments below, you know, like the video, subscribe if you haven't. Let us know what we could do better. You know, we do check the comments. I do respond to them. So, you know, thank you for watching our videos and y'all have a good night.
All right, guys. Good one.